So this is actually a talk about our passion for functional programming, and this is a talk about the most disruptive and valuable feature that functional programming that we have found during our years working together for different clients and so forth. And this disruptive feature is not immutability, it's not higher order functions. It is the effectiveness of functional programming for leaving side effects aside, for segregating side effects. It is the feature that refers to the capability of functional programming of purifying your code, of allowing you to write programs that are free of side effects. And then you also see a reference in the title of the talk to object-oriented programming. And this is because this talk is also intended to show how we can migrate from object-oriented programming to functional programming. It is intended to show the similarities and differences that there are between functional programming and object-oriented programming, and showing the role that side effects play in this migration, okay? So our plan for the talk is following. We will start about talking about the problem that side effects represent and the challenge, the design challenge that they pose. We will then put side by side two solutions for this design challenge. The object-oriented solution, the typical object-oriented solution that we normally apply, and then the functional programming solution. And then we will, once we see clearly the similarities and differences, we will evaluate both approaches in order to see how and why we should embrace functional programming and why we should embrace programming without side effects, okay? So, what are side effects and what are pure functions? When we talk about pure functions, we will talk about functions which are free of side effects. And this is a small sample. All the code samples that we will see are written in Scala. But hopefully, I think that they will be mostly understandable, even if you don't know Scala. I explicitly avoid to use some more advanced feature of Scala, such as higher kinds and this kind of stuff, so that the level of understanding of Scala, even if you don't know anything about Scala, I think that it will be possible to follow the samples. Okay, and this little function, this is a pure function, and this is a pretty naive example. We will see later a more realistic, yet simple example. Okay, but what this example, what I want just to illustrate is that when we have a pure function, what we have is a function that receives some input data, and then it manipulates this data in order to return another kind of data. In this case, we receive two integers, and then it returns a new integer that represents the sum of both of them, okay? And this is a pure function. And this is, pure functions are like mathematical functions, okay? The only thing that they does is to receive some information, okay? And manipulate these values and return another value, okay? And all the information is in the signature of the function. Now, we have this other function. And this is it is almost the same function that before, but with some print and some logging trace here in the code. Mathematically speaking, we are still computing the sum of two integers, okay? But now the signature of the function doesn't reflect what the function actually does, okay? Because in this case, what we are doing as well, besides returning an integer, what we are doing is doing some side effects, in this case, a logging trace, okay? And this is like cheating the compiler, okay? Because the signature of the function doesn't reflect what the function is actually doing, okay? So this is a pretty nice example, okay? We have here another example, and this example will allow me to advertise the Madrid Scala meetup and invite you to join our meetup group. The example that we are going to use throughout the talk, okay, consists simply of the implementation of a microservice, which allows some client some user to join a meetup group, okay? And these are the functional requirements. The functional requirements, very briefly, is are the following. If the group is not moderated, okay, then the user that attempts to join the group automatically is created a new member for him, okay? And then the user is registered within the group. Otherwise, if the group is moderated, then this joining request is registered and it is kept pending for approval by the moderators, okay, by the organizers of the group. And then it may happen that if the user or the group does not exist, then nothing will be changed. The state of the application, the state of the meetup community won't be changed at all. And of course, an error should be returned to the user. So we want to implement this functionality, and we want to implement this functionality in terms of a RESTful architecture, okay? And then from this point of view, we have the user who is using this browser, for instance, and then we will have the any web client, okay? And then we will have our meetup.com service running on the server, and then we will represent these attempts to join a meetup group using a post request, and then in the body of the HTTP request, we may refer to the user, to the identifier of the user that wants to join the group, this group is identified in the path of the HTTP request. The server once it receives this HTTP request, what we'll do is to answer and to respond with an HTTP response like this. In this case, for instance, a new member will be created, okay? The response may be different if the group is moderated, a join request could be returned, or if in case that the group does not exist and not found, will be returned, and so forth. So, in essence, what we have to implement is this kind of function. It's a function that receives an HTTP request and then returns an HTTP response, okay? So the question is now, this function is pure or is impure? This function, in order to return this HTTP response, in order to return this value, can be implemented solely on the basis of the information that you receive here. Can we return this response, this not found, or this join request, or this member, only on the basis of the request? The request, the only thing that it refers to is the user and the identifier of the user and the identifier of the group. So in this case, this is completely impossible that this function is implemented in a purely functional way. This function cannot be pure, okay? It is impure, and it is impure because we will have to go to the store, to the persistent storage, in order to see whether this user, okay, exists or not, or whether this group exists or not, okay? We have to retrieve the information about the group in order to see if the group is moderated or not, and so forth. So all these reference to the persistent storage are side effects, okay? And we need this information because this information, of course, it is not receiving the input of effort. Also, as part of the implementation of the function, as part of the functional requirement, I didn't mention, I think, that there are also notifications that are performed and that are addressed to the organizers in order to inform or communicate that there is a new user or that there is a pending request for approval and so forth. So these are also side effects. These messaging instructions, okay, are also something that has to be done. And this will be done when this HTTP response, when this function is computed. more effects, more side effects that we may launch or we may decide to be launched when this function is executed are logging. So this is an analytics in order to inform the business about the different events that are being generated within the community and so forth and so forth. Okay, so side effects are quite common in real applications and anything useful that we want to build is of course something that will be tied to side effects. Okay, but side effects are also said that they are a bill, almost a bill. Okay, and this is because it can be said that if you can easily understand or text or fix or reuse or compose or extend some piece of software that you have, then this is because, most probably, because your side effects are not properly handled, okay? And now you know it. And sorry for this reference, okay? Maybe if you are not from Spain, maybe you don't know this meme, but it's quite popular here. And why is it the case that if you have functions with side effects, it will be difficult to understand and test and reuse and compose and so forth and so forth? Well, this is because if you have a function that has side effects or has dependencies other than the ones that are declared in the signature of the function, then you are not guaranteed that you will be able to reuse or compose this function because you do not know the hidden dependencies that this function refers to. And these hidden dependencies might be quite far ago. Okay, you look at the implementation of the function and then it is not enough. You will have to go and to see the other functions until you discover that this function at four levels of depth, okay, it is calling a database. Okay, or is this making like a call to the database? So this makes it really difficult to reuse and compose this application. Also, when you have a function with a side effects, you are not guaranteed that that the only thing that it does is the thing that is declared in the signature. Okay, and this is also have a lot of problems for optimization and so forth. So what we will do is to consider that okay, we have to program pure functions. We have to program functions that are free of side effects. But at the same time, okay, we need side effects because someone eventually has to call the database. Someone eventually had to call the logger and the analytic engine, the mail server, or whatever. So the design challenge that side effects pose to us, okay, is that we had to live with side effects, but we can do whatever is possible in order to segregate these side effects as much as possible from our code, and at the same time decoupling this part of our code that is side effectful from the part of our code that it is free from side effects. Okay, so visually we can illustrate this this design challenge using this image, and you will see here two major parts. This is our whole code base, okay, and you see here one part that is side effect free, which is cleanly and order and whatever. It's mathematical, okay? And then you see another part of your code that it is where side effects are launched, okay? And this is quite messy and ordered and so forth. So choose whatever images that you like, but the thing is that in our code, there will be two parts, and this side effect-free part, we want to be as larger as possible, okay? We want this part of our code to be the most important part and the bigger as possible, and we want of course also that these parts are completely decoupled in the sense that changes that will be caused in this part doesn't affect the code that is implemented, the pure code the pure code that is implemented in this side effect free part. Okay. And this is the design challenge. We should look for abstractions, and we should look for ways of implementing our code in such a way that the pure part remains as big as possible, and the impure part, that it is it will be there always, okay, is as decoupled as possible from the pure part. Okay, so let's see how we can accomplish, or how we can deal with this design challenge from an object-oriented perspective. Okay. What we do when we have to segregate these side effects, or we have to deal with the implementation of this microservice, and by the way, all the code that will be shown can be found in this GitHub repository, okay? In order to segregate all these effects, what we normally do in object-oriented programming, and it is a very good thing to do, is to follow a design principle, the separation of concerns design principle, and first of all, we want to separate, to decouple the presentation layer from the business logic layer, okay, and then we will have, okay, the function that we had to implement, but then we will implement some bridge functions that allow us to translate the HTTP request and response to business objects that are completely decoupled, or that abstract away as much as possible from the different presentation media that we will use in order to communicate and to implement these services. So now our problem is that we have to implement this function. And this is what we normally do in object orientation. We will define a join request object that represents the request, the joining request. But that will be, it won't be an HTTP request. It is a domain object, okay? And we will return a join response. The join response will be either the new member, or it will be the join request that has been registered, in case that the group is moderated. And now, this function, of course, is will be full of side effects as well, okay? In order to... what we are doing in the implementation of the function is essentially what we had to do here. The only difference is that the format of the information is different, okay? But still, in order to register a new member, or to register a new joining request, okay, we had to assess the database, okay? So all these effects that we found here in the implementation of the function are still here. Still, what we want is to implement this function at the business level by making exclusively reference to the functional requirements of the application. What we want is to implement this join function at the business level in terms that match as much as possible this description of the functional requirements of the application, that will be to check that the user exists, the user that this request refers to get the group information, if the group is moderated, register the request, okay? And otherwise, create the new member. This is what we want to implement. These are business requirements, and we want the implementation of this function to reflect as much as possible this kind of pseudocode that is written here. And in order to achieve this goal, what we, of course, can do is to implement this function in this way. Because here, of course, we are, in order to check if the user exists, okay, what we are doing is to make a direct reference to the database, using, in this case, the Slick framework. Okay? We are making reference to the user table, to a relational table of users, and then here we are querying this table making a reference to the identifier, to the user identifier, and then we are collecting the result. In this case, what we do is simply to get the first response of this query that it is written in Slick, that it is a very popular framework in for accessing relational databases in Scala. Okay. And you see that this user identifier comes from the specification of the join request. The join request refers to the user that wants to join this group. Okay, and the user and the group are referred to here through identifiers. And this will be the identifier of the join request that when we receive this request, this identifier will be known because this request is not registered yet. Okay. So we don't want to do this. And we don't want to do this. Why? Because we are in mixing concerns. We are mixing the concerns of business logic and persistence. And we want to do this, why? Because if eventually we had to change the database framework that we want to use, of course, if we are doing this, then we will change. We will have to change the functions that implement the business logic. Okay? So it is the very same goal that we talked before about. Okay, that it is to decouple as much as possible the side effectful part of our program from the pure part. So in order to achieve this goal of doing a better implementation that of this function that refers exclusively to functional requirements, okay, what we use typically in object-oriented programming, okay, with a typical pattern, okay, is to use interfaces, object-oriented interfaces. And in these object-oriented interfaces, what we include is a collection of methods that represent, well, the typical side effects that we need in order to implement our functional requirements. We will have some functions to get the user, to get the group, to put to register a join request, to register a new member, and so forth. Okay, and then the particular database framework that will be used in order to get the group, the user, and so forth, will be implemented in a specific implementation of this interface, of the store interface. We may have an implementation for MySQL using Slick. We may have a relational implementation using SQL or whatever. We may have a testing store, you know, to use unit testing or NoSQL store and so forth. But the important point is that we define this interface in order to decouple the business logic, okay, from the particular bits that refer to the side effects related to persistence. Okay? And using this, this approach, what we can do is to implement the functional requirement that we see here in pseudocode, we can implement it in this way, which is probably is the most concise way to implement this logic. We get the user, the information about the user we don't want, we don't use it, but we will, if we manage to get this information, it is because the user exists. Of course, we may have include an exist user method in the interface, okay? But I didn't do it just to make the sample simple. Then we get the group, okay? From this identifier of the request, we get the group, and then if the organizer must approve the joining of new members, then we will register this request. And otherwise, we will put a new member, okay? We will register a new member. And then the response will be either a register join request or a new member, okay? A new member object. And what you see here is that in case that we have to register this join request, we will use this left constructor. This left constructor is just a means to create an object of the type either for this type, for the join request. And otherwise, if we use the right constructor of the either data type, then we will wrap this member object in an either type, okay? So this either type is something which is part of the standard Scala library, okay? But the idea of this type is simply to be able to represent two kinds of data. So this is the implementation of the functional requirements. As I said, it is pretty concise, and it is pretty readable. Okay? It is difficult to improve this implementation. And of course, what we will have is all the concerns related to persistence will be delegated or will be relegated to the implementation of the interface. In this case, this, we may get something like this. We will get the get group implementation that will open a session, and then we will have here the query for the group table and so forth. Okay? But the important thing is that all these details are encapsulated in the implementation of the interface, and that we can keep our business functions without making any reference to this stuff, to this low-level stuff, and to this side effects. Okay. However, of course, the join function is still impure. Okay. Why? Because when we call the get user and the get group and or the put join or the put member functions from the interface, this interface will be implemented using the Slick and so forth, and they will make calls to the database, and they will launch exceptions. Okay, when the user do not exist, the get user will return an exception. Okay, and this makes this join function impure. This makes that when we run this join function, there will be side effects. And there will be effects that will be executed, okay? Unless we have an implementation of this interface that is pure, that might be, because we might, for instance, implement a unit testing implementation of this interface, and the user will return something which is fixed, okay, for each identifier, something like that. But in production, okay, what we'll see is that each join function is impure. But, well, what we get is something that I said is something, is an implementation that do not make, doesn't make direct reference to this persistent code, okay? So this is why this function from join request to join response, I put it in brackets, okay, in parentheses. Because it is not really pure. It is not something that belongs to this part of our code. And what we see is that in this solution, okay, what we see is the barrier that separates these two parts of our code, the pure and impure part, are object-oriented interfaces. Okay? So this is the object-oriented solution, and this will be the solution that we are going to confront to the functional solution. And the functional solution, what we see is the application of this principle, which is that functional programming is, to a large extent, programming with pure functions. Okay, functions which transform input values into output values and do nothing else. Nothing else. It is simply a transformation of values. Okay. And the idea of purely functional programming is programming as much as possible using this paradigm, using pure function. Of course, we won't be able to use functional programming to implement the functions or the code that we need in order to call the database. To call the database is something that will be have to be done using another paradigm. Okay, it won't be purely functional programming. But the idea is this. And what we will, in order to show, or in order to explain how it's, the function, how the functional solution look like, we will start by considering how can we purify this getUser function. This getUser function receives an integer, and it will return a user. Okay, and this is the very basic function that we found in the interface, in the object-oriented interface. And the efforts of purifying, okay, our functions in the case of the object-oriented solution stop here. And what we will see is that the functional programming allow us to extend the realm of pure functions even in this case, okay? And the functional trick in order to purify this function is the following. Instead of making the get user function to call directly to the database, what we will do is to return a description of the effects that we want to be executed. Okay? And delegate into an interpreter the execution of these side effects. Okay? So this is the functional trick, or this is the, in essence, the functional pattern. Okay? To return programs, to return descriptions of the effects that we want to be executed instead of being responsible for directly calling this, executing these effects, okay? But in the case of the getUser function, it is almost trivial. Why? Because in order to get the user from the database, the effect that we want to execute is get the user with this identifier from the database and execute it, okay? So this description that we have to return in this case is simply like execute this effect, execute this instruction, okay? And then what we will have is a run function, which is the function that will be in charge of executing this instruction, okay? And this run description function will be something like this. Okay, if the description that we receive as input is of this kind, execute the getUser function, then call the database, query the user table database, etc., etc. See, this is the same implementation that we saw before in the implementation of the object-oriented interface. Okay. So this example is somewhat, shocking because why do we do this? Why are we reifying this getUser method and defining here a data type that represents the effort that we want to be executed later? Why are we doing this? Well, we will see later. Later on, we will see the value of doing this kind of decoupling, the value of dividing this function into parts, a part that is in charge of computing what we want to be executed, and a part that is in charge of executing what we want to be executed, okay? Okay, but this description, what is this description about? Well, if we are talking here about instructions that have to be executed and about something, an interpreter that will be in charge of executing these instructions and these descriptions, what we are talking really is about programs. What we are talking about is that the programs that will be returned, a program that will be returned by the getUser function. This description that is returned is a program. It is a very simple program indeed in this case, okay? But it is a program nonetheless. And it is a program that is parameterized with the result that we will get when this program is interpreted. In this case, the getUser function what returns is a program that when executed will allow us to obtain the user. That refers to this identifier, okay? In this case, the definition of this program will be something like this. We have the store program. This store program is, this trait is like a class. And these are the different cases, the different types of programs that we need, that we have, and that we will be able to write and return and compute. In this case, the only thing that we have is an execute constructor that receives some instruction and represents a program. These instructions will refer to the different effects that we need in our domain. In this case, we will have the get user, the group, the put member, the put join instruction types. And this is in one-to-one correspondence to the different methods that we saw before in the object-oriented interface, okay? And this is what we have now. And using these definitions, we can purify the getUser function. But of course, what we have to do is purifying not only this simple function, but also more complex functions like the join one. The join function, what we will have to be done now is to, instead of returning a join response, now what we have to return is a store program that when executed, when run, it will return a join response. Okay? this is what we have to do now. And what we see is that this joint response, and this is a thing that can be, this is something that can be emphasized. This type here, you have to understand this parameter of this program not as something that it is part of the data type. For instance, if we have a list of users, if you have a list of users, what we will have when we have an object of type list is a list that have instances of users, okay? What we have now is not in this data type, we don't have any user, okay? When we have this get user, and this is an store instruction that return a user, okay? What we have here is this not, you do not see any field, any field in this data type, okay, that refers to the user. This user has to be understood as something that will be returned, okay, when it is interpreted. And this is a particular case of a phantom type of the same kind that John Preddy talked about it in his keynote this morning, okay? So think of this parameter as something that something that will be returned, okay? But well, now how do we how can we purify this join function? The join function, you look at it at the functional requirement that we have to implement, and you see that we are not making reference just to one kind of effect. In the getUser function, we refer just to the effect that allow us to get a user from the database. Now we are making reference to get the user, to get the group data, to join, to register a new request, to register a new member, and so forth. We are making reference to a lot of effects. And what we see is that with this kind of programs, we are not allowed to write a description, to write a program that refers to multiple instructions. So what we need is to do something like this. We have to introduce new constructors. We have to introduce new types of programs. And the constructor that we are introducing here is a constructor that allows us to define, to create a new program out of two other programs. A first program that will be run, the get user, okay? And then with the result, with the result of this execution of this program, that will be a user. Remember that the getUser program return a user. With taking into account this user that will be returned eventually when this program is executed, then we will run another program. And this another program that we will run is again a composite program. It is a program that will run first this getGroup program, and then with a group that will be obtained eventually when this program is executed, then we will do either a put join or a put member, okay? And when we, let's say that we have to put a new member because the group is not moderated, okay? The organizers don't have to approve the registering of new members. Then we already have a new member, and this member is the one that has to be returned, okay? But how do we return a new member? Remember that this run and then constructor, the first part, the first argument that it receives is a program. It's a program that will return something that will allow us to write, to proceed with the execution of a new program. So what we have to put here is a program. But the only kind of programs that we have right now is execute this instruction and concatenate these two programs, okay? So we need another type of program, and we need a type of program that simply allows us to return a value, okay? And this value that we have to return here, it is not the register, it is not just the member, but the left or the right wrappers of this object, okay? So this is and this is no longer an impure function. Implemented in this way, this program, this join function, what returns is data, is a value, okay? And it is a value that represents a description of the different effects that has to be executed in order to return a join response, either a new member or either a new request, okay? And so the new program that we have is a program that can be either a return value program, this will be a pure program, a program that doesn't have any kind of instruction, doesn't have any kind of side effects, okay? Execute some instruction, and then this sequencing constructor that allow us to concatenate the effects that are represented by this program at the resulting program that it is obtained, taking into account the value that will be returned when this first program is evaluated. Okay? Of course, we now have more complex programs. Our program before just consisted of an instruction, execute this instruction, and the interpreter that we had to implement had to take care just of those instructions. But now we have also to take into account that our programs might be sequencing programs and, or might be just a return value program. In this case, the evaluation, okay, in this case is very easy because our program is just says return this value, the interpretation will be this value, okay? And in this case, what we have to do in order to interpret this type of program is run first this program, and taking into account this result, we apply the next function, which represents the continuation, okay, and then run the resulting program. Of course, this implementation is pretty inefficient. This is not very recursive and doesn't take into account another kind of optimizations. If you see real implementations in libraries like scalaz or cats and so forth, you will see better implementation. But my point here is just showing you that if we have more complex programs, then we have to modify our interpreter and make it more complex, okay? And guess what? What we needed were monads, okay? Monads are just methods, are just type constructors that for which we can define these two methods. Returns method that allow us to leave a pure value into our type constructor, and a flat method that has this signature, okay? But of course, these two methods in our case are implemented pretty directly, trivially, because in this case, what we have in this flat map combinator, what we have is this our sequencing constructor, and in this case, what we have is our pure constructor. Okay? So don't fear the monad, don't be afraid of monads, because monads are just type constructors that allow us to do some kind of imperative programming. Okay? And this kind of imperative programming is represented by these two constructors. A constructor that allows us to sequence programs, and then a constructor that allows us to finish our computation by returning some pure value. Okay? And this is the essence. Taking into account this syntax, okay, we can define very, very general combinators. And we can define very general combinators because this kind of imperative languages are everywhere. Okay, we talk a lot about monads, and we can think of monads as being ubiquitous because imperative languages are everywhere. Okay, languages that allow us to represent that you have to do this now. You have to execute this instruction. You have to execute this effect, and then you have to execute this effect, and then you have to execute this effect. If this happens, then you have to execute this step, this effect. Otherwise, you have to execute this other effect. This is pretty common, and you will find the need of expressing this kind of programs in a lot of domains, and that's why monads are so common. Okay. And of course, what we can do with monads is defining very general combinators. For instance, we can define this map function that allow us just to modify the return value of a given program. We have this program that returns values of type U, and then with this function, what we want is just to modify the program. What do we do? Just execute this program, and then with the return value, what we return is the the application of this value to the function that we receive as argument. Using this, this map combinator, okay, which showed that monads are functors, what we can do is to implement also general combinators for lifting the result of our program to another type. For instance, if we have a program that returns an X value, we can implement this left operator that that represents a new program that wraps the value that will be returned by this program into an either. Okay? And so we have this program and map the result and wrap it in an either data type. And using this monadic combinators and operators and these new combinators, we can write our previous program in this way. But the important thing is that what we are doing here is exactly the same that we saw before. What we are returning is a program. It's a description of the instruction that we want to be executed. Okay? And we are using this flat map and return combinator, okay, implicitly here within this left and right combinators, okay? But what we get here is a pure function. It is something that when you run it, nothing will be called, the database won't be called at all, and et cetera, okay? And well, this is not as nice as the implementation that we got with object-oriented programming, but we are pretty close. The only thing that it happens in order to be closer to this implementation is to use what it is called in Scala for comprehensions. For comprehensions, that it is a special syntax that Scala provides for us in order to write this kind of monadic code. And that in the case of F-sharp, it is called computation expressions. In Haskell, they are called do notation and so forth. But if we have some type constructor for which we can implement these flat map and math methods, that it is our case, then we can write our flat map combinators, okay, using this syntax. And this is with a spoonful of sugar, okay, and this azúcar. Pues, what we get is something that it is pretty close to the object-oriented program. This was the object-oriented implementation, okay? And if you see, what we have got is this other program. This other program, okay? This is the object-oriented implementation. This is the functional implementation. If you see, here the only difference is that what we have here in the functional implementation is that we are no longer cheating the compiler. What we are returning here explicitly in the signature of our program is that this is a storage program. This is a program that we will include instructions for executing inside the fence against the database, okay? Whereas in the object-oriented program, this information was not in the type signature, okay? There are also differences in the way in which the variables are assigned. In this case, in the for comprehension syntax, we use this arrow here. In this case, we use the equal sign and the val keywords and so forth. And then in order to return a value, we use a result here, and here it is just place. But the important thing is that you see that the only difference is in the kind of abstract syntax tree that we are using to represent our programs. Here, we are using the Scala syntax tree, okay? And here, we are using our own data type. We are here using our own syntax, the syntax that we have defined in order to represent our programs, okay? So this was the architecture in which the get user and get group has these side effects, and the functional solution, this get user and get group doesn't longer have side effects, do no longer have side effects. The join function, of course, still relies, because as you see, we have ended up with almost the same solution. And the difference is that we have been able to decouple the interface of the persistent storage facility that we need in order to write our business logic and the interpreter that is needed in order to execute these programs. Okay? And this double interface here is the one that is the key in order to obtain the advantages of functional programming. Okay? And we will see now. What we see is that in our case, the barrier that we use between the pure and the impure code are no longer object-oriented interfaces, but are algebraic data type. Algebraic data type, I didn't say it, but are just the types of the kind of types that we defined before. Our store program is the data type, and this data type is actually defined in terms of sums or of products. Okay, each case in the data type definition is a product. Okay, and the collection of four cases is the sum of the time. That's why they are called algebraic data types. And we have seen that this store program, okay, is also was also monadic in our case. But the important thing is not that it is monadic. The important thing is that we are returning our functions, return a value, return a description of the effects that we want to return. This is the important thing. The point that this program is monadic or not is something that is secondary. Okay? So, very quickly, the evaluation. Of course, we have more capability in the case of functional programming to segregate side effects. Okay? And in order to evaluate the decoupling, what we will do is to consider this, hypothetical scenario. We want to change from SLIC 2.0 to SLIC 3.0. Okay? We want to change our database framework. And the database framework is something that, of course, is something that is used in this impure part. When we change from SLIC 2.0 to SLIC 3.0, what we see is that what we will return now when we execute some query is a future. Whereas in SLIC 2.0, what we return when we execute this query was a group. Okay? So this is the change now. Of course, we had to change the implementation of our store interface. And now, this get group that return a group, what we had to deal now with is with this query that will return a feature. So how do we return a group from a feature? Of course, what we had to do is wait for the feature to be completed. And of course, we can block. This doesn't make sense. If we want to use asynchrony, okay, we can't block here. This undermines all the purpose of the change. So what we do is to, of course, change the implementation of the interface here, of this, the implementation of this method. And we change the signature, and we return here a feature. But, of course, what we have now is to change all the interface. And changing the interface will force us to change all the business logic that was implemented using this interface. And does it make sense that we refer in our business logic to features, to execution context, and so forth? It doesn't make sense. So what we see is that these OO interfaces of object-oriented programming leak side effects. These are not very good barriers between pure and impure code. Okay? And this is why. Because we have only one interface. The interface, the signature of the get user, get group methods is shared by the business logic and the interpreter and the implementation. And if the implementation demands a new signature, then we are forced to change the business logic because they both rely on the same signature. However, in the case of the functional interpreter, the functional solution, what we see is that we have this interpreter that has this signature, and what we have to do now is to change this signature that returns a user, return a feature. But this doesn't have any impact in the way in which these programs are obtained. The store program is exactly defined using the same get user, get group, and put join, et cetera, instructions. The API for our functional program will be changed at all. Whereas we can change the signature of our interpreters freely. And this double API, this decoupling that we did between the API for the business logic and the API for the interpreters is what allows us to behave to block any change that we have here, and to have code, functional code, that is pure, and to encapsulate all our business logic in a completely decoupled way from infrastructure matter. Okay. So very quickly also, who runs faster, this program or this program? This Scala program that we use in order to represent our computation, or this other program? Well, the Scala interpreter will run faster, of course. But the important thing is that when we have the chance to implement our interpreter, we gain a lot of chances to use exploit parallelism, distribution, asynchrony, and so forth. And this is a key win in order to get performance, okay? And this is exactly what happens in the case of Spark. In the case of Spark, we do not have here monadic programs. We have resilient data set, distributed data sets, okay? But we have transformations that this map, filter, and so forth, that compute an RDD. And then we have actions that will be in charge of executing these RDDs and distribute the tags between the working nodes of the clusters and so forth. But the essence is the same. This is, Spark is functional, is purely functional, because we have here an algebraic data type that allow us to decouple the way in which this data set will be computed in a cluster and so forth, and the definition of the data cluster. So, in conclusion, it is all about languages and interpreters. It is all about defining languages that allow us to decouple the definition of our effects and the interpretation, okay? And this is what allows us to free the interpreter from the host languages and give us chances to execute using asynchrony and so forth, and also to decouple the impure part from the pure part, and to consider that object-oriented interfaces can be considered harmful, okay? Beyond monads, there are way more stuff to be learned. Okay, we have Raul talk us about free monads, Clay's list, they are in order to combine different type of effects, mass transform, mega products, and so forth. And well, the good news is that you don't have to implement all this stuff, because using a Scala set or cats, shapeless, you get a lot of things for free. And instead of doing this, you can implement just this stuff. Okay. So this is a recommendation. This is a very good book on functional programming, okay? And you can learn a lot of about purely functional programming from it. And thank you very much. Sorry, I think that I took some more time. And see you soon at Scala. Questions? But you mean that the interpreter takes into account, takes care of all the types of programs, you mean?
Like the monadic construct has some logs, so I guess you are...
Okay, but the logs, monadic logs, no, this cannot be expressed in Scala. Either you can use a Scala check and other kind of property-based testing frameworks in order to check these logs, of course, yeah. Yeah? Arrows instead of monads. Yes, you mean to this type class arrows, or do you refer to arrows from category theory in general?
Like in Haskell, I don't know about Scala.
In the Scala set, I don't know if arrows are the type class arrow is implemented or not. No, but I think that he refers to arrows. Arrows is in the type classopedia. Arrows are a type class that it is not exactly the same as the arrows in category theory. Yes, sure. But we can discuss it later. I mean, the fact that this is something monadic or not, it is not the point of this talk. Is just making awareness, raising awareness about the important thing of defining your algebraic defining with algebraic data types your programs. These programs might satisfy the constraints of monads or arrows or whatever, applicative or monad plus or whatever. But the point is to define languages and to return programs instead of executing directly the thing. Some more questions? Okay, thank you very much.